remember that thoughts that may be going through your head don't matter that much as you sit here. There's a stillness underneath the thoughts and in between. From the point of view of thought, that is nothing. An alert stillness. It's in everyone, even those who are completely trapped in mental noise. One could say, so to speak, underneath that there is a pool of stillness, but they don't know it. And that stillness, as it arises, when the screen of thought loses its density, then from underneath thought stillness arises. And the arising stillness is what I call the new state of consciousness. And as you know, all words are limited. And the reason why we are here is to allow that to happen. And in many of you, even before you came here, that arising was already happening. So here there is an intensification of it, or a deepening. And as I pointed out yesterday, you're not really here to add anything to your mind. That's fine. Those, you can go to lectures at universities and add things to your mind. That's fine, but the reason why we are here is not that. Pointers the words are not there as added baggage to your mind, but they are simply pointers beyond that, helpful pointers. So we are here for the arising of presence. One could say an evolutionary transformation, because so far most humans have lived and are living in a very different state, the normal state of consciousness, which is continuous thought streams and identification with those continuous thought streams as a self, a me. So everyone carries a heavy burden of personal selfhood, if that's a word that exists, I think it does. Everyone carries this, the burden of a personalized me contracted and personalized sense of self. And I say burden because there is a heaviness to it. And as you go through life, you feel this heaviness, and people perceive it as this, the heaviness of living. Another day, and more stuff happening, and another problem. What's the point of it all? The last straw, that's the last thing that I needed. So there's the burden, and then there comes the last straw. And it probably won't be the last. And so there's this heaviness of me. I have to carry me around all the time. And if that weren't enough, there's the living past in me, both personal and racial, meaning belonging to the whole human race, and the pain of that, because humans have generated so much pain through living in such a way, reducing their lives to a little personalized sense of self, which sometimes tries to make itself bigger by identifying with a collective, a tribe or religion or nation, but it's the same heaviness. Identifying with a collective for a moment looks like liberation from a little personal me, but it's the illusion of liberation. In fact, you've gone into something even worse, even heavier. So then humans carry pain inside from the human past, emotional residue of emotional pain, of suffering. And they don't see it as that. Through unconscious identification with it, it becomes part of one's personalized sense of self. So it was heavy enough already, and now it gets even heavier because the whole heaviness of human existence in a state of consciousness that could be described as ignorant, not ignorant in the sense of not knowing enough, but ignorant of who you truly are. So you carry the burden, really, of the whole of humanity with its heavy past and believe it to be yourself. And then you interpret whatever is happening around you through that. And you can imagine, and perhaps you know from your experience, I know it from my past experience, how distorted everything gets when you interpret the world around you through the heaviness of a painful, often, more often than not, painful, personalized sense of self, of me. And then you see all those situations out there and all those people out there that seem to have been put there by some demon to make my life painful. That's the interpretation. And that's what it looks like. That's what the world looks like from that point of view, ultimately illusory viewpoint, perspective. And then you begin to fight against situations and people because you perceive them as your enemies. And then you create the world that when you switch on the TV, that's what you see when millions live in that way. Not that each one manifests that condition in the same degree of intensity. No. The degrees of intensity, the degrees of ignorance that manifests through you differs. Nobody in this room probably would perpetrate acts of terrorism or carry a bomb around on your body and go to a public place and then detonate it and eliminate yourself and another 100 people. That requires extreme degree of ignorance, but it is the same mechanism at work, the same misinterpretation, the same fighting the external enemy to get rid of my pain. So that's the human condition. And again, the human condition is not a personal problem of yours. It is the human condition. Now, that personal sense of selfhood sometimes dissolves in the face of extreme danger. We talked a little bit about it yesterday. It can dissolve in the face of imminent death sometimes. It can also dissolve when there's intense suffering, which of course is generated by that itself. So the redemptive factor about the whole sad story is that the very suffering that it generates for yourself and others ultimately wakes you up too, because you can't stand it anymore. So there is a self-destruct mechanism built into the illusion. By the grace of God. But that could take time. Unless you run out of time. And so the alternative to needing more time for that to happen, to become free, and the alternative to needing more suffering, needing more pain, needing more drama, until finally you can't stand it anymore, the alternative to that is sitting here. And in a much more gentle way, allow that personalized sense of self to dissolve, because it wants to dissolve. Or rather, something is emerging from underneath that wants to, it's pushing through. So when I said it wants to dissolve, that's not quite true. It doesn't want to dissolve. It does and it doesn't. It wants to continue. It has a momentum. But ultimately, it also wants its own destruction. Yes, the two are true. And you can see it in excessive cases of extreme manifestations of that so unconscious state that it seeks its own destruction. If it can destroy others in the same process, so much the better. We can see it in, reflected in the events of past week. You can see it in certain in many people's lives that are very unhappy. A self-destructive urge in many, almost addictive. I certainly had it, and it worked. The self destructed itself. Now you may have, this is a gentle way of the arising of presence, you may already have gone through more violent forms of transformation, of suffering. You've had your suffering. And perhaps that's cracked you open. There was the screen of mind and of thought streams and the density of pain body and identification with all that of me, a dense, heavy personal selfhood. And then perhaps for quite a few of you, something happened either to you or some in your surroundings, to someone very close, and it cracked open that dense density. And whether it was some great loss or an illness or an accident, or suffering or death of someone very close to you, the crack appeared. And at first, of course, a crack like that is very painful. Nobody likes to be hit on the head. And then comes, you begin to realize the enormous grace that is suddenly in your life and that came into your life because of that. And then so much presence begins to emerge through that crack, one could say. The sense of personal selfhood loses its density and something can shine through. Ah. And with that comes a depth, because you have no depth. You have depth, but you don't know it when there is only that screen, when the crack appears, suddenly there is a depth to you. Somebody that I watched on television the other day talking about the disaster of last week actually said, the writer, she said there was, she perceived through the suffering, there was a deepening, a shift from type A personality and a deepening in the collective psyche of this country. And that may be the case because all these things apply whether on the personal or collective level. With that comes a depth and there comes a humbleness, a humility, no longer a me that needs to triumph or control. And if it cannot triumph, it can at least be triumphant in its misery, because it's greater than yours. Mine is greater. Just listen to it. And then a point is reached, and many of you, most of you, perhaps all of you, have reached the point where there's already presence arising. Not continuously, it can get covered up again occasionally, yes. A personal sense of self can return even during our retreat. The complaining heavy me is back. It may happen to you. It can come upon you suddenly as you sit here. And you may have to run out of the room. Now, don't let this stop you from going to the bathroom if you need to. What are they going to think of me? So it can suddenly come back, the contraction, the heaviness, the pain body can react. In some people, the pain body would react particularly here because, and again, we haven't even addressed the pain body directly yet, we will. It may react particularly here because it feels threatened by the emerging presence. Pain body is an aspect of the personalized sense of self when it's unconscious. When it's conscious, the pain body is simply the pain body, old accumulated pain, not all that problematic anymore. It's only when it's unconscious, it is part of the sense of me, and it then controls your thinking, it runs your mind. Then that's, you may have to run out of the room, or you may get up and shout, "No, no, this is not right." Or it may shut off, you're not hearing anymore. It can do strange things. And so, since pain body, except in very rare cases, cannot be dissolved all at once, but it can be seen now for what it is, so when it arises, all that is necessary is for you to recognize it so that it doesn't become of part of a heavy personalized me that is reactive and then interprets everything through that. Mm. look at all these people. What are they doing here? And you're immediately interpreting through the pain and distorting through that. And you're distorting, of course, your own life through that, your own, the view of me, who I am. And when you see it, so there's enough presence for you now to see it when it comes. You can't stop the pain body. If it wants to come up, it'll come up. It's old pain. You carry it inside. But if you see it for what it is, it's no longer that much of a problem. It's a bit like a physical pain, which in itself is not a, it may be, it's painful, yes, but not a problem, not the heaviness of problem. Unpleasant, perhaps, but you don't, if you don't label it even, it just is. It is a turbulence, or it may be a heaviness, or it may be a painful contraction, whatever the predominant energy field of your pain body is, there it is. And it passes, especially if you don't feed it with thinking along the same lines as the pain body, same kind of thoughts to reflect the energy field of the pain body. There's enough presence for you to watch it instead of allowing it to run your mind, and then it becomes a me. That's the fundamental difference. When that shift has happened, pain body is fine and it begins to dissolve. It is no longer part of the personalized sense of self then. And that removes an enormous chunk from the heaviness of a personalized sense of me or self. Certain mind structures, of course, are still at work. Identification with mental images of me, problems of self-esteem, and all kinds of things, who I am, an opinion about yourself, or many conflicting opinions about yourself, good enough, not good enough, who knows? And the same mindset creating opinion for others, who they are, not as good as me, better than me. A possible threat to my sense of self, I need to defend, or maybe I can incorporate them into me, my sense of self, that I could be bigger with that. And then I find a trophy wife. Trophy wife is an expression that I read, it's relatively recent, for somebody who chooses a wife because he's already wealthy and the last trophy that he needs is a good-looking wife to enhance his sense of self. So self-esteem, of course, part of the sense of self. Now, I've already removed, we said, the pain body is already, when you're aware of pain body as it arises, a lot of the heaviness is already gone. What remains still is the mind structures, and again, you need to see those when they operate. Recognize them for what they are. If you have problems with self-esteem, it's opinions, viewpoints, images in your mind of me, of who I am, me, as not good enough, not as good as, better than, and that varies. Some of the Eastern teachers, when they come to the West, the Western mind is very developed. Even the East has ego too, but the Western mind is even more developed. And I read recently the Dalai Lama, when he first came, started doing some teachings in the West, when he was quite many years ago. He was with a small group of Western students, and somebody mentioned self-esteem, problem with self-esteem, and he said, what's that? And it was explained to him, and then he went from one person to another and asked them. Lack of self-esteem was explained to him. And then he went from one person to the next and asked them, do you have that? Lack of self-esteem. And most people said, yes, I have that. Oh. And probably not a single sutra of the ancient scriptures mentions that. Because when those scriptures were written, the mind wasn't as advanced yet as it is now. So to see that and hear, this is quite a helpful environment for you to see whatever arises, either emotional, and particularly the heaviness of the emotions that are the past accumulated pain that lives in you as an energy frequency, and to watch the mind thought stream as it's there, it comes and goes. And the more that the watcher arises, the more the sense of who you are, sense of identity, sense of I am-ness shifts from being this mental construct, mental emotional construct, which after all are only formations, energy formations. So your sense of who you are shifts from being, believing you are those energy formations, forms, to being the observing presence, that which sees all that. Another word that I used yesterday, I always give you different pointers. If one doesn't work for you, the other one might. You are the spaciousness in which the emotional and mental constructs and conditionings operate. That's the liberation. You cannot perfect or infinitely improve the construct, the emotional mental construct. If you improve it at one end, then you lose something at the other. They're always polarities. If you become good at one thing, then you lose your ability on somewhere else. So there, it always exists, it has the limitations of form. And when you see your own limitations of form, then that's fine. The seeing, there's something unlimited in the spaciousness that sees all that and allows it to be. That is where you are unlimited. And that is the realm of, that is the spiritual dimension, if it has any meaning, that's what it is. That is your true nature, as it's sometimes called. Beyond form, and it arises simply through the arising of the witnessing presence that allows whatever is there at this moment to be. And then you may become aware sometimes of that power that lies in that spaciousness, that witnessing presence. And as it arises more in you, through you, that becomes greater, vaster. It always was, but now you realize that is vaster than anything that happens in it. So it could happen to the most unworthy, in quotation marks, judged as the most unworthy and pitiful and seemingly deluded human being who had a life of sordid events. It could and has happened, can happen. It does not happen through perfecting the me. That would be nice. Everything would be neat and tidy, and we could say we can now embark on a course like a university course where you have 101 and then you start from there. The mind likes that because it's neat and tidy. And you can finally graduate up to enlightenment. But the eruption of that can come at any time, and it comes often to people with very unfavorable conditioning, often a very heavy personal sense of selfhood, so heavy that it has inflicted pain on many other human beings. Can happen. And then, of course, that pain is, more and more pain is self-inflicted, and suddenly it goes. So you cannot predict to whom this will happen. And not even, for many people, it might not even be perceived as an event, a particular event. It could be a gradual dissolving. But as it does, and you no longer, the shift now happens, and you are the witnessing presence, and you realize that's who you are, and you feel that, and not all the stuff that's been going on in your mental emotional field, not that you deny it, no, you see it. But you're not looking for yourself there anymore. Emotional, conditioned energy streams, mistaking that density for who you are, or for who that other person is. So you become a blessing because when you have seen the reality in yourself and the illusory nature of identification with that mental emotional conditioning as the me entity, then you're no longer imposing, perpetuating and fueling that illusory sense of self in others by reacting to it, because the illusory sense of self energized by the pain body, they continuously strengthen and feed each other through reacting to people around you. That's how the whole thing keeps going. And of course then you will see the density often still operating in others, and you realize beyond words that is not who they are. You were trapped in the same illusion. And density means they are identified with mental, emotional energy formations. This is a heavy me. And then you would say, oh, react to it. that goes because only the me, when you're still trapped in it, strengthens itself through reacting to others. So you can look through that density, which perhaps that in the other person, because you've gone beyond it in yourself. And as you witnessed, and as you continue to witness the same in you, you witness it and allow it to be in the other person. And by staying present with that, being the observing witness and allowing it to be, you no longer recreate the illusion of an identity, making an identity for that person out of the unconsciousness. And in that sense, the Course in Miracles puts it quite beautifully. There's a line which says, whoever you meet becomes a witness for either Christ or the ego, whatever you perceive in him or her. Christ means that your true nature, one way of putting it, you could say Buddha nature. So whoever you meet, whoever you come into contact with, any human being in your life will witness. Witness means confirm to you the truth. That person can confirm to you that your illusion is true, the witness for the ego, if you perceive. That is what the ego is, the egoic me entity, the density. So whoever you meet can witness, say, yes, I was actually right. That's who he or she is. So that person becomes witness for the ego. And continuously, through this misinterpretation, the truth of the illusion, the truth in quotation marks, the truth of this illusion will continuously be reflected back to you and confirmed. And the truth, the absolute truth also, everyone you meet can also become the witness of Christ, which is Buddha nature, your true nature. When you do not mistake the density for who that being is. And that's becomes part of your spiritual practice is sitting here. Other part of your spiritual practice is going out into nature. We may talk about it in more detail also. And so allowing presence to arise. And then comes the part, presence being there when you are interacting with others. That only works if a certain level of presence has already been reached in you. Otherwise, the moment you start interacting with others, you will get drawn back into identification with mental, emotional sense of self. Presence would not, unless a certain level of presence has been reached, presence cannot sustain itself when it is around heavy mental emotional energy fields called people. So people are really challenging. Wouldn't it be easy if it weren't for other people? Just nature. And there are some people, also spiritual people, so to speak, who avoid interaction because it always, sooner or later, leads to problems. I've had enough. But that's the very ground where you're being tested, and you can find out for yourself your degree of presence, not in any judgmental way, but it'll become so clear when you're with people. And when you're being challenged, and of course most challenges will come through other people. That's how it happens. You may get challenged occasionally through a natural disaster, but it's relatively rare. You may live next to a volcano and get challenged by an eruption, but it's rare. So most challenges come through other people at you. And then what comes in? How do you meet the challenges of mental-emotional entities coming at you and wanting something from you, as they all do? Or fearing you and thereby misinterpreting you completely. So how do you meet the challenge of other people, the challenge coming at you? Perhaps heavy pain bodies coming at you. Like a steam train. Or very heavy minds coming at you, extremely problematic minds, and people identified who have their sense of self in very heavy mind streams. After I saw the film called Titanic, there was a scene where they show in the bowels of the ship the steam engines at work, and they're enormous engines. That's before it goes down, of course. And they're and occasionally when I meet people who are very identified with mind the engines of the Titanic. And you know what happened to that. But quite impressive, too. Quite. So they are coming at you. And then what can happen is either you meet it through presence and spaciousness of presence, the alertness of presence, the openness of presence, and it comes there. Or you meet it through the reaction of the little me. It reacts. And immediately you're drawn to the same frequency as that. And that entity that's coming at you wants that. It's not even an entity, it's an energy field that's coming at you, wants you to contribute to its own vibrational frequency. So it'll do, it's all unconscious, of course. There's not the person coming at you and doesn't say, I want to see how much pain I can get back from that person. They believe that they are right and you are wrong, or whatever they believe, or that you did something to them, and so on. But there it is. So you can meet it. Presence, openness, which is non-reaction. And that requires considerable degree of presence. Or you fall back into a little reactive me, and you shout something back. Me? I did that? You did that to me. I didn't do that to you. That's only the beginning. Oh. So even when that comes at you, not mistake it for who that is. That is not the reality of that person. They may also come to you a suffering entity, needing to tell you the story of their suffering. Perhaps they're coming for help. How do you meet that? How do you help? Increasingly, people would be coming to you for help because presence is arising in you. And many people underneath their conditioning are ready for it. So they may feel drawn to you because they see something in you. But they're still immersed in their story, and they're telling you their story. And it may be very complicated story, very complex. How could I, what can I possibly say to that person? The problem seems so complex. And again, are you trying to work something out to help, or simply be there in that field of spacious presence that is so much more intelligent than the little mind, and just hold the field of spacious, that spaciousness, that presence, in which it seems that you don't know anything. Stay with the not knowing. And there's the alertness of that state. And then see what comes. Nothing may come, that may be enough. Or a shift may happen in the other person, because you're not giving reality to what ultimately is illusory constructs. You're not giving that reality either through reaction or through getting drawn into the story completely. Yes, you truly are in a bad way. Yes, you truly have dreadful problems. On the surface, they look true. It's looking beyond that. Before you, presence can be sustained in human interaction, go out into nature easier. And even and out in nature, you have a choice now. You can meet the tree, you can perceive the tree through mental noise, in which case you hardly really perceive it, because immediately there is the mental concepts, or you can perceive the tree through stillness or presence. That is much easier than a human being to start with, because the tree exists in stillness itself. It grew, it's growing in stillness. It's even if you carefully, if you stay with a tree or a flower, see how still it is. But it's alive. It has its own intelligence, considerable intelligence, that beauty, only an aspect of the one intelligence, of course, manifesting as this form. But it's so still, it's even surrounded by stillness. it has no problems. That's why it's easier to be with a tree initially than to be with a human being. It teaches you the state of no mind, no thought, because it lives in that state. Anything natural lives in the state of natural, original connectedness with the One. Everything in nature lives in that state of grace still, that humans have moved out of because they've gone out from the One, the Source, into fragmentation and multiplicity more and more, and that's the human mind and the complexity of the human world. Lost touch with the original oneness, innocence, grace, beauty. It's still there, but they where? And so everything in nature can teach you the state of grace. If you can be with it truly, now I'm not with it when you perceive the tree through mental noise that says something about it or labels it in one way or another, has thoughts around it. You're relating to your thoughts, not the tree. So it teaches that state of no mind. But for you, the state of no mind, when you re-enter it after losing it for so many thousands of years, you do not return to that level of pre-mind, so to speak, that the tree lives in, the state of original grace. You return to it, it is a state of rising above thought, and all language has limitations, so it's just a pointer. Humans are rising now above thought into the state of no mind, which has certain essential similarities with the state of original connectedness that natural things and animals still live in. And yet, there is an added depth and an added knowing to it when humans return to that state after having moved through the ignorance of mental being identified with mind totally. It was a necessary stage, it seems, in human development, this egoic stage of growth. It's coming to an end. And it's critical because it cannot survive in this form, that state of consciousness. The egoic state of consciousness cannot survive now. The planet cannot survive with that. So we return, and yet it's more than a return. In the state of having gone beyond thought, thought can still operate when needed. It's not that you forget everything. Thought still operates and operates beautifully. But no longer a self-seeking thought. Thought becomes free of a sense of self. Your sense of self is far vaster. It is the stillness around thought, and for thought only is a small aspect that operates in there when it's needed. And thought can be very powerful and creative when you need to create something, but not as a separate me that needs something. Creating because you are part of the totality and the totality wants to create something through you, and then thought may be extremely powerful when applied and you want to create something, not because the little me needs it for its satisfaction, but because the totality moves through you. And it is then when humans will become able to manifest, to use a New Age expression, to manifest from within in ways that would now seem miraculous, because now, if they were able to do that now, they would create even greater havoc than they are doing already. Imagine little egos manifesting what they want. If people, to some extent, they are manifesting, of course, the external world, but manifesting in a more direct way. So if you needed something, it will immediately be there. It would be dreadful. But when humans become free of the illusory sense of self, and then power moves in also to manifest, but not as a separate me that needs something, as part of the whole, the totality, the one. So in that sense, thought of the mind can be a powerful way of manifesting something, but it won't be powerful until it becomes free of selfhood, free of the illusory sense of self in there. And so, and then also it loses its problematic quality. The mind is no longer heavily problematic. So that happens. I rarely talk about those things because they happen naturally by themselves. Usually all I address is what is needed, pointers that are needed to become free of that. The rest happens. So no longer we are moving beyond being thought-based, mind-based entities, beyond. And so but everything in nature can remind you of the state of connectedness, but when you encounter that state, it is the same and yet not the same as the state of grace in which nature exists. It is deeper. There's a deep knowing to it. But use anything in nature and be with it. Anything can be a teacher. If you just stay with it for a while, it could be a flower, a little plant, a tree. It could be a river. Just be with it for a while and watch it. And become aware of not only it, but also of the observing presence. So nature is the teacher of stillness. And that is your opportunity here, surrounded by beautiful nature. I would advise that even if you have come here with a friend or partner, that occasionally you take time to be alone with nature. Maybe choose one tree, choose one flower, one plant, be with it for a while. Stand there or sit there. And sense the stillness that is there. And then all labels go. A tree is far more than a tree. Every label reduces it immediately, as if you knew what is there. Every mental label gives you the illusion of knowledge. You don't know what that is. How could you know? It's a mystery and it will remain a mystery. It is a beautiful being. The surface, it looks like a tree, perceived through the senses. But it is a mystery. Everything is a mystery. And it's only mental labels give you the illusion that you know. The moment you say, oh, that's a tree. What do you know? Nothing. It's just sounds coming out of your mouth. You may have heard the word self-realization another pointer. And that can easily be mistaken by the mind for knowing a great deal about yourself. And you might think that after 25 years of psychoanalysis, when you have examined everything you can possibly examine about yourself, that would finally take you to self-realization. That accumulated knowledge of all what that make up the inner, all the conditioning, the content of your mind. But really, I mean, I have nothing against it. On its own level, it's fine. You become acquainted with the content of your mind. And self-realization doesn't mean that you know a great deal about yourself. The closest you can get to it through words is to say that you are, that you don't know anything anymore about yourself from the point of view of mind. Of course, you still have some knowledge when it's needed, but really there's a space of not knowing. It looks like ignorance almost. Yes, from the point of view of the mind. Who are you? I don't know. And that's not a comfortable state for the mind. I don't know who I am anymore. I need to figure something out. I need to have a few thoughts in my head, a few images that tell me who I am. Surely I need that. And then the amazing thing is when you become comfortable with not knowing, and there is some knowing in there, but it's not nothing to do with bits of knowledge. There's a deep knowingness, one could say. You're simply a field of aware presence. If there's anything that you needed to know truly at this moment, it would come out of that. If there was anything that you truly needed to do at this moment or respond to at this moment, it would come out of that. Unprepared, unpremeditated. It's there. It's, one could say, the totality acting through you. And it's just right. And then you're back in not knowing, because nothing needs to be known. And then, if you can be with another human being in that way, you become a great teacher. The great teachers, and quite a few of you are destined also to teach, but I'm not, please, no new identity, no. I'm considering a career change. I'll try a spiritual teacher. But quite a few of you are destined, otherwise you wouldn't be here, to become teachers, either in a more formal way or simply because you can't help it. It just happens through you. But only because you no longer have an image of you as a spiritual teacher, and you are not in, you don't feel that you know when you are with someone. As long as you feel that I know the answers, just come to me and I'll tell you. The spiritual teacher doesn't know. The spiritual teacher operates from the spaciousness of not knowing, from stillness, alert alive stillness. That is the teacher. Presence is the teacher. No human entity is the teacher, but your true nature is that. So in that sense, you are the teacher. But there is no personal identity that could claim to be a teacher. The moment you claim to be a teacher, the spaciousness and the openness of presence is lost. And perhaps you can then teach from accumulated knowledge, but it's no longer truly true and powerful spiritual teaching. It loses the essence. So the sooner you become comfortable with that state that from the point of view of mind looks like not knowing anymore, the more effective, the more powerful you will become as a spiritual teacher. The strange thing, just a little comment, every time I walk in here, or anywhere I come to talk, there's always this strange feeling, I have nothing to say. What? The first, when I started doing this kind of teaching, a few times the mind came, because there's still, of course there's a mind, but it doesn't have a lot of power. It just occasionally comes in with a thought. What am I going to say? I've said it all. And then, oh, it's fine not to know what to say. It's actually quite beautiful, which would be the greatest nightmare for the mind, is to sit somewhere on a stage and quite a few people have had this nightmare. I've forgotten my lines. What am I supposed to say? So you begin by being comfortable with not knowing in front of a tree. Or you look at the stars at night, amazing. The vastness of it all. What could you possibly figure out in your mind about it? What thought could possibly be in your mind that could be really meaningful in the face of that vastness? The mind has to stop. That was my earliest meditation. I realized it later when I was a child. I would often go out at night and look in awe at the Milky Way and the billions of suns, because almost every star is a sun, and the Milky Way, which is just this luminosity across the sky, and it's billions of suns, and the vastness of space. That's the greatest awe, is the vastness of the spaciousness around it, the distances, the space. And there I would simply look, many years later I realized, oh, that's meditation. The mind stopped. Later on, my mind wouldn't stop anymore. It became more and more noisy until finally it gave up. But so again here, not knowing, become comfortable with that. It is not the state of not knowing that is the state of that you enter when you drink some alcohol or take certain drugs. Because what if you drink a scotch or something like that? For a moment, it can feel better, because the mind can sometimes become less noisy, less obsessive. Oh, you become a little bit free of that heavy self after the second stiff drink. And then, but you're not moving beyond thought, you're moving below thought. You're beginning to move towards the plant realm. Which is beautiful for plants. And so you drink a bit more and a bit more, and finally it goes, and you've lost consciousness totally. So that it takes you, but for a moment it feels good, because it also takes you out of the mental me. It can also activate, as you move towards unconsciousness, it can activate in some people the pain body too. They get violent after a few drinks, and then they become unconscious. So, not knowing, that's not the not knowing that we talk about. There is an alertness to that not knowing. And you not know with your whole body. There's an alertness throughout your being. And there's even an alertness, it seems, after a while, around you. And that alertness is still, but alive. And that is pure intelligence, pure awareness, pure consciousness, before it becomes a thought, before it becomes something. The ground. I could ring this bell, and the sound of this bell is perceived in stillness. After the sound subsides, there's stillness, relative stillness, not total, but it doesn't matter. The ultimate stillness is within. It is simply cessation of mental noise. Then a perception happens. A form arises. In this case, it's a sound. And then the form dies, as every form dies sooner or later. And what remains then is the pure field of awareness. Then another sound arises in the awareness, my voice, and goes. There's the undercurrent of awareness in which it happens, that remains. Always, unconditioned, still, pure consciousness, pure just that. So in any phenomenon that arises, instead of being totally drawn into the arising phenomenon, realize that in which it arises. The spacious, aware presence. So there is, that is the dimension. That means then you know the world, but you also know God, the One, continuously connected with that. Not connected, you are that. That is your true nature. And that was put beautifully in one of the ancient Upanishads, the ancient scriptures of India, some of which were written 1,000 years and longer ago, 2,000 years. And he talks about the nature of God, Brahman. What is that? What is Brahman? What is God? And it defines that like this, it says, not that which the eye sees, but that whereby the eye can see. Know that alone to be Brahman the eternal, and not what people here adore. Not that which the ear hears, but that whereby the ear can hear. Know that alone to be Brahman the eternal, and not what people here adore. Not that which the mind thinks, but that whereby the mind can think. Know that alone to be Brahman the eternal, and not what people here adore. So there is the truth, the closest that words could ever get to the truth is that. And yet the truth is not in the words. They point to it. Not that which you see, that which makes seeing possible. The field of aware presence. Not that which you hear, that which makes the perception possible. The field of aware presence. Not that which you think, that out of which all thought comes. The one intelligence, the one awareness. And knowing it, not in a dualistic sense, but knowing it as yourself, your essence. Some people who realize that made the mistake of declaring joyfully, I am God. But they were misunderstood and killed in many cases. It's better not to say it.